Good morning and welcome to St. Michael's Church as we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And today, as we continue our deep study into Genesis, our theme today is trust. Welcome to those of you here in the sanctuary and those of you online with us around the world. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom now and forever. Amen. As we pray together, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And let us now confess our sins to Almighty God, kneeling and taking a moment to reflect on those you have hurt or those who have hurt you. Praying together, Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker and judge of us all, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and offenses which we have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your righteous anger against us. We are deeply sorry for these our transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sin, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Remaining standing, let us pray. Set us free, loving Father, from the bondage of our sins. And in your goodness and mercy, give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The lesson is from the book of Genesis, chapter 11, beginning with verse 27. Please follow along with me in your pew Bibles on page 8. Now these are the generations of Terah. Terah fathered Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran fathered Lot. Haran died in the presence of his father, Terah, in the land of his kindred, in Ur of the Chaldeans. And Abram and Nahor took wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife, Milcah, the daughter of Haran, and the father of Milcah and Iscah. Now Sarai was barren. She had no child. Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his grandson, and Sarah, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth together from Ur of the Chaldeans to go into the land of Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. Continuing with chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I shall show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran, and Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he moved to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent. And Bethel on the west, and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we pray Psalm 91 responsively by whole verse. Whoever dwells under the defense of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
I will say unto the Lord, you are my refuge and my stronghold, my God in whom I will trust.
He shall defend you under his wings, and you shall be safe under his feathers. His faithfulness shall be a shield and a buckler.
You shall not be afraid of any terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day.
Of the pestilence that walks in the darkness, nor of the sickness that destroys at noonday.
1,000 shall fall beside you, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you.
Indeed, with your eyes you shall behold to see the reward of the ungodly.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Please follow along in your pew Bible on page 835. Matthew chapter 28 and beginning in verse 16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw Jesus, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Help us, O Lord, to be so connected to you that we might become your disciples and the servants of others. Take our lips and speak through them, our minds and think through them, and take our hearts and set them on fire. Amen. Please be seated. Some years ago, a father takes his firstborn son and stands him on the railing of his back porch, and then goes down and stands on the lawn, encouraging the little fella to jump into his arms. And the dad says, "I'll catch you, just jump." After a little more coaxing, the boy finally makes the leap, and as the sweet little boy is flying through the air, surprisingly, the father steps back and lets the child fall to the ground like flat on his face. A little bruised and confused, the son looks at the father. The father picks him up and says, "Son, let that be a lesson. Don't ever trust anyone." Now, you're looking for a little better of an ending to that story, weren't you, on that one? But, you know, in a way, doesn't that kind of describe our culture right now? Trust no one. Live cynically. Don't believe anything you read, and always look over your shoulder. Well, thank God for Genesis chapter 12 and the story of Abram. Genesis chapter 12 can be summed up in two words: remarkable trust. But I need to back up a little bit. As we move through Genesis this fall, last week you heard Randy take us into Genesis 11 and that Tower of Babel, how sin is like kudzu that towers over and suffocates the ancient peoples. Yes, because of their repeated sin, God is angry at the people, forcing him to cut back the human race from the face of the entire earth. Genesis chapter 11, a bit further on, tells us, believe it or not, that there is now only one faithful family left. One faithful family line left. And that is the family line of Shem. One family line on earth that had maintained the knowledge of God and passed it faithfully from generation to generation. From Shem's extended family, the Bible whittles the faithful to just the family of Terah. And you were wondering, why did we read that long genealogy? But genealogies teach us about God's fingerprint through the generations. But horror of horrors, in Genesis 11, 27, we do come to Terah, but we discover that the name Terah means moon, meaning the last family thought to be faithful, thought to be preserving the one true God, had gone to the dark side and began worshiping the idol god of the moon god. And how do we know that? In Joshua chapter 24, God says, "Long ago, your fathers lived beyond the Euphrates. Terah, the father of Abram and Nahor, they served other gods." My friends, it looks like the last family, the last man, the last hope is gone. the human race has hit a dark, dead end. And I wonder, my friends, have you ever experienced that kind of darkness, that kind of hopelessness? No hope, the midnight of your soul, darkness all around you, and there is no way out. Have you ever felt that level of the depth of dark? You see, only when we put ourselves into the darkness of Genesis 11 will Genesis chapter 12 help us discover the power of God's love and remarkable trust. You see, out of that hopeless darkness, and from a place of love, God whispers, Abram, 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 leave your country, leave your people, leave your pagan religion. Go to a land I'll show you. Trust me, and I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you to bless others. I will protect you. Trust me, Abram, through you, I am making an entire new chapter of the human race. God taking initiative, intervening to save humanity through Abram. My goodness, this is the moment Abram is introduced to the world for the very first time. Yes, he is the same guy as Abraham. His name would be changed 5 years later, five chapters later, when God makes a declaration over him. But here he is, plain old idol-worshiping Abram. Abram, God says, trust me. Leave that security, your friends and your pagan religion. Now, I want to take a step deeper into that, and I want you to put yourself into Abram's shoes, okay? Two major problems that could have prevented Abram from trusting, amongst many others. First, you know, we talk about Abram here like he's an energetic 30-year-old with a new wife ready to take off in his convertible. But the Bible says Abram is 75 years old when he's asked to do this. Going from paganism to monotheism at 75. It's hard enough to change your football team affiliation at that age, right? Imagine your whole worldview, your whole biblical worldview changing. Don't ever, any of you, tell me you're too old for ministry, because Abram proves you're wrong. I love the story told by Walter Pitkin in his book, Life Begins at 40. Pitkin says, you know, a few days ago, I was playing with some boys and I hit a double. Granted, when I got to second, my breath was still on first and my heart was on third base. Age does not mean being complacent and being backward looking. Abram, 75, making this most amazing decision. Second, God, did you notice? God does not even tell Abram where he wants him to go. I mean, at least when the Reverend David Booman last week made his announcement about his departure, you know, to the Reverend David Booman, God said, look, David, take your wife Katie and your boys, go to Sumter, South Carolina. You will find a church there on 213 North Main Street. Lead it. Not so with Abram. Abram, go. At some point, I'm going to show you what that looks like. For now, go. And we hear that repeated in Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Abram obeyed God when he was called out. He went out not knowing where he was going. Remarkable trust. How many of us have said, Lord, I'll go only if I know where I'm going or where that could lead? No such grace here for Abram. Now, the biggest thing for any clergy and clergy spouse is this question. How on earth would Abram get his wife on board? You're 75. Now, to all clergy spouses out here and listening to this, can you imagine Abram saying, Sarai, we got a situation. I know we're getting up there in age. I know we worship other gods right now, but God talked to me and he said there is only one God and he wants us to leave everything and go to a place that he won't even show us yet. Are you on board? Oh, to be a fly on that wall. We can't romanticize this. This is crazy. This is radical trust. And out of that radical trust, verse 4, Abram left. That's his answer. Abram left. Would you say that with me? Abram left. A little louder. That's good. You all beat out the 7:30 and the 9 o'clock services. But this is both a remarkable initiative of love from God, a remarkable grace-filled initiative of grace, and a remarkable trust from Abram to lead like this. It was C.H. Spurgeon who said, you know, to trust God in the light is nothing, but trusting God in the dark, now that is faith. And Abram, in the darkest, bleakest moment, takes that walk, that foot out before the other and goes, proving you and I absolutely do not have to have a certain amount of knowledge before we trust. Do you think Abram knew everything about this monotheistic God? No. We may not know our destination, and of course, age does not matter, either on the young side or the older side. Remarkable trust. My dear friends, let me ask you this. In this crazy world that you and I live in right now, I wonder if your trust in God has been eroded. Maybe you watch the news and you're disappointed in thing after thing, and perhaps you're in a time of darkness where dreams and your own joy has gone dark. The world depresses you, and you realize this morning that maybe you've gotten off track with God. And I wonder, could this be a verse 4 day for you, where like Abram, we're willing to say, God, I trust you. I make a declaration. I don't know where you're heading me. I don't know where I'm going, but you do, Lord, and I trust that. Would you, Lord, destroy the idols of my life? When Abram left, those idols had to be destroyed. An idol, by the way, is anything in life we choose over God. Addictions, workaholism. Idols can even be the good things like hobbies, kids, travel ball, for goodness sakes. God, take me, take us to a new place of trust. Wipe out the idols in our life. But you might be here this morning saying, oh, I can't. I'm not there. I'm no Abram. I'm nowhere near 75. I can't trust that way. My response to you is this. You're right. You can't. It is not natural for you or me to trust in this kind of a radical way. Back to Abram. The Bible says, remember, Abram was blessed to be a blessing. He wasn't blessed only for himself. He was blessed to carry on the blessing. And what is that blessing? It is this. 41 generations after Abram, the blessing of the Savior of the world, Jesus, would be born from his family line. Through Abram's line comes Jesus, who came to die for our sin, to give us life, that all who believe and trust in his name will live. And not only live, but receive the Holy Spirit, who gives us the strength to have remarkable trust. It's a gift. We cannot do it on our own. And I hope that's a relief for you for two reasons. Number one, no matter how bad my family line is, God will redeem it. Thanks be to God, right? And number two, the fact is, look, I know I can't do it on my own, and only when we know that can then the Lord go with you. As I remember our bishop teaching, you know, when we're active, God is passive. When we're passive, sometimes God is active. And we say, Lord, take over. Take it over. Give me trust like I've never had before. And that, my friends, is actually the reason that what I'm about to say to you is completely counterintuitive. This is why God gave us the gift of, dare I say, the tithe. Tithing, you see, is an x-ray. You take an x-ray to see if a bone is broken in your arm. Tithing is an x-ray to see if our trust in Christ is broken. Tithing answers the question, do you really trust me? Do you trust me or not? What is the tithe? The tithe is giving 10% of all I've been given back to Christ who gave it to me in the first place. And we know that 10% of anything is a lot. And it's certainly, you're not making a contribution to the Lord or a donation because it's actually his before it's yours. So that's an impossibility. So it's really more than money. Forget the money part. Tithing is the test God uses to ask, are you really trusting me? And I know that like Abram, there are many reasons not to trust, and for us, many reasons not to tithe. For the younger generation out there, you will say like my children, well, once, Dad, I have a regular income, then I'll tithe. That's a broken trust. For those in midlife, as soon as I pay off all those school tuitions and car payments for my kids, I will trust through a tithe, broken trust. Those elders we give to other good causes like the Symphony and the United Way. Again, mistrust, broken trust. Through the Holy Spirit, following the trust of Abram, the x-ray of the tithe reveals that level of trust. It's why in Luke 16, Jesus says, whoever can be trusted with the small things can be trusted with big things. But my friends, let me pause here and say that I believe there is a lot on the line for Christians today. The global Christian movement needs a new surge of Abrahamic-like trust from each of us and everyone throughout our country right now. You know, during COVID, when so many churches were shut, you know, it was then when all that chaos and evil just surged forward. And now it's time for the Christians around the world to surge like that water after a hurricane. That surge has got to come through now. Tithing Christians rising up in trust, taking on great things in his name. But in addition to tithing, for some, this might mean trusting God by getting back into the habit of worshiping in person in the sanctuary. Maybe some of you have gotten into the bad habit and need to get back into your pew, back into the sanctuary. In fact, I want to give you some examples of trust over these last two Sundays at St. Michael's Church. You heard 2 weeks ago about how, out of trust, Eric Nelson is dedicating his life to ministry to the courts, and he invited you into it. That might be God's call to you. Trust him and watch the blessing. Though like Abraham, you may never know where it will lead you. Last week, you heard how out of trust, Shay and Sean Chambers have dedicated themselves to the sanctity of life for every age. And they invited you to that walk for life. That might be God's call to you. A call to trust him, again, not knowing where it will lead. Taking that step out, you exist to be the blessing through trust to another. And we would say, come, Holy Spirit, remove our idols and obstacles and give us that trust to step out and into action. Well, finally, this morning, I end with the story of Herbert Howells. It was actually his hymn that we just sang before the gospel reading. Herbert was a composer born in England in 1892. Herbert and his wife had one child, and that child's name was Michael. He was an only child and therefore was absolutely, totally adored like any only child can be. But Michael contracted polio. And despite every known treatment at the time, tragically, Michael died. It crushed Herbert to the core, crushed him to the point he knew that he had to make a decision. In fact, in a way, he was like he was in that fulcrum of Genesis 11, darkness surrounding him. And out of anger and despondency, he could have taken the turn to abandon God like never trust him again and live in a wounded spirit, or Herbert could embrace the Father still and trust the Lord to deliver him. Herbert began to trust, and he poured his life into his music by taking refuge in Jesus. And the result was the writing of that hymn we sang earlier, "All Our Hope on God Is Founded." And by the way, the music, the melody of that hymn has a name. The melody is called Michael. But hear the words of that hymn again. "All my hope on God is founded. He doth still my trust renew. Me through change and chance he guideth, only good, only true. God unknown, he alone calls my heart to be his own." My friends, your age doesn't matter. Knowing the destination doesn't matter. With the courage of Abram, through the strength of the Holy Spirit, trust, take action that would bring the blessing. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that you did not leave us in Genesis 11. Thank you that you intervened. Thank you that Abram said yes. Abram left. Lord, would you help us be a verse 4 kind of people, to trust you when we don't think we can, when we don't have the strength to. Through your Holy Spirit, give us what we need, Lord, to be faithful, to trust, and to walk in places we've never been. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Dearly beloved, Scripture teaches that we were all dead in our sins and trespasses, but by grace we may be saved through faith. Our Savior Jesus Christ said, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." And he commissioned the church to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Here we ask our Heavenly Father that this child, being baptized with water, may be filled with the Holy Spirit, born again, and received into the church as a living member of Christ's body. Therefore, I urge you to call upon God the Father through our Lord Jesus Christ, that of his abundant mercy he will grant to this child that which by nature he cannot have.
The candidate for holy baptism will now be presented.
I present Paul Frederick Rees IV to receive the sacrament of baptism.
As we enter our baptism today, the word trust is mentioned nearly half a dozen times to the parents and grandparents, godparents of Paul Frederick. Take note that raising a child in God's name is a total exercise of trust in God the Father. Today, on behalf of Paul Frederick, you shall make vows to renounce the devil and all of his works, to trust God wholeheartedly, and to serve him faithfully. It is your task to see that Paul Frederick is taught, as soon as he is able to learn, the meaning of all these vows and of the faith that you will profess as revealed in the Holy Scriptures. Paul Frederick must come to put his faith in Jesus Christ, learn the creeds, the Lord's Prayer, the Ten Commandments, and all of the things that a Christian ought to know believe, and do for the welfare of his soul. And when he has embraced all of these, he is to come to the bishop to be confirmed, that he may publicly claim the faith for his own and be faithful and further strengthened by the Holy Spirit to serve Christ in his kingdom. Are you willing and ready to undertake this?
I am, the Lord being my helper.
Do you renounce the devil and all of the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the empty promises and deadly deceits of this world that corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the sinful desires of the flesh that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce them.
Almighty God, deliver you from the powers of darkness and evil, and lead you into the light and obedience of the kingdom of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now do you turn to Jesus Christ and confess him as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you joyfully receive the Christian faith as revealed in the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments?
I do.
Will you obediently keep God's holy will and commandments and walk in them all the days of your life?
I will, the Lord be my helper.
And now, will all of you witnessing these vows do all in your power to support Paul Frederick in his life in Christ?
We will.
And now let us join with these candidates to proclaim our faith in the words of the ancient baptismal confession, the Apostles' Creed. Please stand.
Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I do. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in Jesus Christ?
I do. I believe in Jesus Christ,
his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary.
He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I do.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us now pray for Paul Frederick, who is to receive the sacrament of baptism, and we have asked his mother and father to lead us in the prayers.
That Paul Frederick may come to confess his faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That Paul Frederick may continue in the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, in the breaking of bread,
we beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That Paul Frederick may walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which he has been called, ever growing in faith and all heavenly virtues.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That Paul Frederick may persevere in resisting evil, and whenever he falls into sin, repent and return to the Lord.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That Paul Frederick may proclaim by word and deed the good news of God in Christ Jesus to a lost and broken world.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That as a living member of the body of Christ, Paul Frederick may grow up in every way into him who is the head.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That looking to Jesus, Paul Frederick may run with endurance race set before him, and at the last receive the unfading crown of glory.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, in your great mercy, you saved Noah and his family in the ark from the destruction of the flood, pointing to the sacrament of holy baptism. Look mercifully upon this, your servant, Paul Frederick. Wash and sanctify him through your Holy Spirit, that he may be delivered from destruction and received into the ark of Christ's church. And being steadfast in faith, joyful through hope, rooted in love, Paul Frederick may pass through the turbulent floods of this troublesome world and come into the land of everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. In water, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. And through water, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In water, your son Jesus received the baptism of John in the River Jordan when the Holy Spirit descended upon him as a dove. We thank you, Almighty Father, for the water of baptism. In water, we are buried with Christ in his death. By water, we share in his resurrection. And we are born again through the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Paul Frederick Rees IV, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Paul Frederick, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit you have bestowed upon this your servant, Paul Frederick, the forgiveness of sin. You've received him as your own child by adoption and made him a new member of your holy church and raised him to the new life of grace. Sustain this child, O Lord, in your trust, in your Holy Spirit, that he may enjoy your everlasting salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It is my privilege to introduce to you today Paul Frederick Rees IV. And he is the son of our organist, Paul, and the son of Tricia. And in making those vows earlier, I wish you could have seen his face. He was overjoyed with the commitments that his mom and dad have made for him to teach him the Ten Commandments, the Lord's Prayer, the Creed. He's got a lot of learning to do. Amen?
Amen.
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 And we get to be in the first row watching this boy grow up in the faith. And maybe he will be a musician like his father or an educator like his mother, but it is that joy that we get to watch as he takes on these vows that were taken for him And so it is with such joy that we pray that 10 years from now, when the bishop says, Paul Frederick, do you believe in Jesus? He will say with great conviction, I do. He is my Lord and my Savior. And so, my dear friends, pray for Paul Frederick on this, the day of his spiritual birthday. Let us welcome the newly baptized. We receive you into the fellowship of the church, confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in the royal priesthood of all his people. My friends, in that joy, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Please greet one another in the name of the Lord.
Hey.
Hey.
Thank
you so
much.
Oh.
He didn't cry.
Well, good morning, everyone. Please be seated. A great joy to, on behalf of your St. Michael's family, the Reese family, welcome to St. Michael's, those of you here in the sanctuary, and those of you online. And so once again, we just welcome Paul Frederick Reese into the family of the household of God. Well, my friends, in your pew this morning, you have a blue Connect card, and if you're a visitor, we ask you to fill that out, as we'd like to know you and know how to pray for you, of course. We also use this card for anyone who is called into ministry or feels that nudge to step out in trust. Let us know what you're thinking about in your ministry through that card. And if you're not receiving our newsletter each week, please fill that out with the email so that we can get to know you, and you can put that card into the offertory plate. Well, life continues this fall as we look towards Super Wednesday, beginning with an invitation for all men to join us Wednesday mornings at 7:30, and you'll see in the back of your bulletin all the things happening from there on out on Wednesdays, including our worship service at 5:30, dinner at 6. You don't have to cook, moms and dads especially. This is a great gift. Join us for dinner. And then we go into our classes. And this particular Wednesday night in our Fear Not class, we will be using the topic, the pulpit versus Hollywood. Who can we trust? And we're talking about social media and all of the Hollywood theology coming out of Hollywood today. And if you're young, this is important for you to know. If you're older, this is important for you to know. As we look to have an apologetic, a faith that we speak into our culture today. So that's 6:30 this coming Wednesday night right here in the sanctuary. Also, as we look at our life together, Operation Christmas Child, we have 700 of these to fill out that will be given all over the world. And so we urge you to take a box home and you can pack it from here. But today is a day where we have our theme of trust. And so you still have time to sign up to be on the St. Michael's Walk for Life team in support of our mission partner, the Lowcountry Pregnancy Center. You can trust God, step out. You can step out with the courtside ministry that you've heard about, with the beautiful ministry going on next door. But it is also a week where we recommit our trust to the Lord through the tithe. And Pat McKinney is here with a testimony of how trusting has transformed his giving. Pat McKinney.
Good morning.
Good morning.
In 1983, as someone in my early 30s, Pam and I were dating. And she invited me to attend church with her at First Baptist down the street. At the time, I was pretty successful in business, and she was a high school math teacher with a master's degree, but making less than $15,000 a year. Well, when the offering plate was passed, I put my $20 in and passed it to her. As she slipped her pledge envelope into the plate, I kind of glanced sideways and was astounded to see the amount on the outside. Wow. She was tithing based on her teacher's salary while I was doing little more than giving God a paltry tip. Well, that little incident stuck with me. And not long after we were married the following year, I asked her how she would feel if we began to tithe, giving 10% or more of our income to God's kingdom. And her answer was very simple. Yes, I've been praying for that for quite a while. For me, it came down to a very simple question. Pat, do you believe in God or do you believe God? Sure, I believed in God, but did I believe God? Can God be trusted to follow through on his promises? Is the word of God reliable? And is there anything in it for me, any reward for believing him and obeying him? Well, once I relaxed my grip on that money and began to open up my hand in giving, God has allowed me to experience the joy of seeing pride in my wife's eyes and a generous spirit being instilled in our children. And let me share one of those priceless rewards this morning. In December of 2002, on my 53rd birthday, here is the card that our daughter Amy, then 17 and a high school senior, gave to me. Dad, when I was growing up, I learned that faith gives life meaning. Prayer is a force to believe in, and love is the glue that binds us all together. And I learned it all from watching you live it. Happy birthday, love, Amy. But then below that, she put in parenthesis, you taught me the joy of giving. Wow. Today, that same daughter is 36, is married to a wonderful man of faith, and has blessed us with two grandchildren. Fellow believers, if Jesus can feed the 5,000 with two loaves and five fish, what in the world can he do with our tithes and offerings? So I invite you to give generously and find out. After all, God makes us the deal of a lifetime. No, the deal of eternity. He gives us everything, and we get to keep up to 90% of it. Do you believe God? Pam and I do. Thank you, Pam. And thanks be to God.
On page 13 of your bulletin, there is a giving card along with five questions and answers about giving. Would you please join us as faithful and generous stewards in submitting your giving card for 2022? And by the way, your card also brings the added blessing of helping us make a responsible budget for 2022. Finally, this morning, if there's anything this morning that you're dealing with or having trouble with in your life, know that we have prayer ministers up front after this service to pray with you on any need that you have. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Seated or kneeling, let us pray. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, Jesus stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah. Let us now pray for those who are unable to receive the Eucharist, to receive spiritual communion, praying together. Dear Jesus, I believe you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people. Then I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. I invite you now to receive communion by taking the mini chalice, removing the bottom lid to reveal and eat the bread of heaven, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. Amen. Opening the top of the chalice to take the cup of salvation, the blood of Christ. Drink this in remembrance. Christ's blood was shed for you. Now, my friends, please stand in the power of the Holy Spirit and let us give thanks by praying together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory now and forever. Amen.
Now, my friends, the peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you in trust and remain with you always.
Amen.
Amen.
Day by day.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us go forth into the world to transform hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah. Hallelujah.